Thank you so much for coming. I thought Tina did a great job talking about forgiveness, which also has a small part in what I want to talk to you about. My name is Stacey, as we've already talked about today, and honestly, I would love to have some audience participation. I'm hoping this isn't one of those boring lectures where I just talk to you and you walk out of here going, well, that was a wasted 15 minutes. So if I ask you a question, please feel free to shout out and answer or raise your hand or just interact. I'm wearing Western clothes today, not because I typically dress like this. I'm doing it for two reasons. A, as a quick reminder that downstairs in the cafeteria, we're having casino night. So since y'all are students, go play and have some fun. But also to draw some attention to some myths that we want to dispel as far as what's the deal with horses. So there's these different kind of outfits. There's the Western over there, and there's English here, and I'm wearing this. I would never wear this when I ride, and most people that you see in Colorado don't wear either of these. Everything that you guys are wearing, obviously without the skirts, is what the average guy wears when you're riding your horse. So what do you guys think of when you see these? Cute. What else? Babies, yeah. They all have fur, right? Furry. They're all furry. They're all adorable. Who wants to pet them?
I want that.
Yeah, absolutely. Exactly. And animals have that response on humans. This is Misty. She's a horse, obviously. What do you guys think about when you see her? Yeah, soft. Who wants to ride her? Yeah, a couple people. Is that the only thing she's good for? No, absolutely not. And that's one of the things I want to talk to you guys about today, is what equine-assisted psychotherapy or equine-assisted therapy does for people. Now, Misty has asked me to come and tell you guys about her occupation today. She's an equine therapist. She works with... She personally works with individuals who are what we would term at-risk youth. And at-risk youth would be those who are in the juvenile justice system, those who are runaways, and those who are in our foster or adoption systems. Now, you don't have to just be one of those particular groups of people to experience equine therapy. Equines also help those with physical challenges. Miniature horses are actually allowed on campus as service animals. They can be used to brace yourself on, to help you walk around. So if you have a disability or you know someone who needs that stability as they go through campus, we are legally bound to allow them to have a miniature horse on campus. Although I don't know that I've ever seen one. Equines also work with intellectually challenged individuals. Those with autism really receive a huge benefit to working with animals such as horses. Those with emotional challenges also experience great healing and relief from their interactions with equines. One major group of people would be our veterans who come back from serving and protecting us. They often have PTSD, and this is one of those things that when they receive therapy with horses, you can really see a noticeable difference between when they walked in and when they've walked out. Also, those who've been affected with borderline personality disorder would be a perfect candidate. Now, why and how does Misty help those? Well, research has proven that just looking at those pictures reduces your stress. But when you pet them, when you interact with animals, be it an equine, kittens, dogs, anything of that nature, cortisol, which is a stress hormone produced by the adrenal glands, is actually lowered, especially when you're petting an animal. There's also been research proven that increase of self-esteem in individuals goes up as well, and that is a person's feelings of self-worth. Another thing that increases when you deal with equines or animals is that there is an increase of self-efficacy, which is the ability to set goals and then see those goals completed. Now, Misty lives at Whispering Withers Ranch. She lives in a herd because horses are prey animals, which means that other animals use them for food. They have that herd mentality. There's safety in numbers. That's how horses prefer to congregate. And they've also been created with a heightened sense of awareness of their surroundings, so that means that they can read your body language faster than you can recognize it in another human. What does a typical EAT session, equine-assisted therapy session, look like? Well, there isn't one. I know that sounds a little vague, but the reason why is because individuals are all different, as well as the horses are different. And then when you add in that you typically do this kind of work in a dyad, which is one-on-one, that changes between the horse and the person. It changes between what you walk in with and what you walk out with. But there are different models. You can use group therapy. You can use individual therapy, and grief therapy are a few of the methods that are used. Now, because Misty the horse has asked me to tell you her story, she wants me to introduce you to Maggie. This is Maggie, and this is Maggie before. You can tell that she's sullen. She doesn't want to have anything to do with anybody. She doesn't want anyone to recognize her. She doesn't want to have any interaction. She came to the ranch very angry, very bitter, and she had a huge inability to trust others because she went through some serious physical abuse with her mother, and she tells her story in this research paper. Afterward, Maggie looks a little different. She has walked out with some self-confidence, bigger self-esteem. She has the ability to forgive. As Tina mentioned before, she had a lot of anger and bitterness towards her mother, but she was the one that was in bondage, not her mom. So she's walked out a whole nother person. She also begins to trust others. And how does she do this? She trusts an animal who doesn't have the ability to judge. Horses don't judge people. They don't look at you and say, well, I don't like the way your hair looks today, or I don't like the way your makeup looks, or they don't do that. They don't have preconceived notions. You're either going to eat them or you're not. Okay? And they don't verbally abuse you. They don't yell at you because you didn't put the water in their horse trough properly. They don't yell at you because you came 2 minutes too late. They don't do any of that, which humans tend to do to each other, unfortunately. They also don't physically abuse people. That was one of the things that Maggie suffered from, was physical abuse. So in Maggie's case, she comes to the ranch for therapy once a week for a duration of 8 weeks. Each of these weekly sessions lasts about 3 hours. What she does is she comes in with a predetermined goal. What does she need to work on this week? It could be something like patience, trust, big one, or communication. Then she identifies a personal strength, something she already has innately that's going to help her achieve these goals. The ability to reason, she can understand things, and she can sit there and patiently watch a horse. Now, this picture here is a pretty big deal. To have a horse lay down, considering it is a prey animal, is significant. It wouldn't take hardly anything for an animal to come and jump on it, and then this horse has lost its life. So for a horse to do this with a person such as Maggie is a significant trust builder. And when the therapist has explained this to Maggie, there's just a natural bond there that is created that we can't explain. We can prove it exists, but we can't say exactly why. It's just there. They also, students learn about their horses through games, play games with their horses. We call it games, but it's actually training. They're training their horses. They're setting goals for their horses. They're setting goals for themselves, and they're learning to continue with this self-efficacy under a guise of we're playing games. One of the biggest things that is beneficial for Maggie is that she spends time with Misty. She grooms her horse. She has to learn to take care of somebody else. This helps her develop empathy and sympathy for somebody other than herself. She spends time grooming. We talked about earlier that when you pet an animal, there's just something magical in that interaction that helps lower your stress levels, helps you be able to have that cognition where you can think and feel and act without being enraged. And then additionally, riding Misty helps communicate effective skills. You can't yell at your horse. Your horse doesn't understand you yelling. You have to learn to speak in ways that's comparable and effective for both partners. So at the end of this, yeah, this is great, but what can you guys do to help? You're gonna now walk out of here with some information that potentially you didn't have before. The onus now lies on you. What are you gonna do with that? Well, you can create social change and promote the acceptance of equine-assisted therapy by talking to your friends, by talking to your family, by talking to your legislators who provide funding for equine-assisted therapy programs for those who need it, our vets, those with disabilities, and in Maggie's case, those who are involved in the criminal justice system. You can also get involved by raising funds and donating them to a ranch, or you can volunteer your own time. So all in all, we all agree that animals are good for us. You guys agreed with me at the beginning, and I'm hoping at the end of this, you will agree that this is something that's effective for other people who need it, and it could be potentially effective for you. So thanks for your time. You guys have an awesome day.